This is an Audio Wool original.
This episode of Fright Day is brought to you by Springheel Jack Coffee. You need great coffee. Jack delivers. Visit springheeljack.coffee.
Hey guys, thanks for listening. If you'd like to support us, go to patreon.com/frightday.
You good?
Yeah.
Fire emergency.
Please don't talk to this person. I'm sorry.
Hey, they found the bodies of at least 3 young boys, 6 more bodies under the John Gacy house. And
one longtime acquaintance describes Dahmer as one weird dude.
Stay tuned for Byron's Serial Corner.
Where we last left off, following an annoying admission of guilt, Nathaniel Bar-Jonah was given the maximum sentence for the kidnapping and assault of 2 boys on the night of September 24th, 1977, and was awarded no monetary reimbursement for the damage a boy did to the inside of his trunk.
Disgusting.
Where he was placed after being seemingly strangled to death. Luckily, he was alive. Originally set to serve at the Massachusetts Correctional Institute at Warpole, he was soon transferred to Concord, where he would stay for the first 2 years of his sentence. Notable inmates at Concord? Malcolm X. The late comedian Patrice O'Neill.
Okay, why didn't Malcolm X kill him?
Well, I don't think they were there at the same time.
No.
Mob hitman Joseph the Animal Barbosa Jr.
Barbarossa?
I think Barbosa is what I wrote here.
I know, I'm just... Barbarossa means red beard.
Huh, cool.
I was just saying Barbarossa. Sorry.
And Cameron LaCroix, the teen responsible for hijacking...
Limoncello flavored?
Not a beverage, but a man.
Damn it.
Responsible for hacking Paris Hilton's sidekick phone and defacing the Burger King Twitter account.
Wow, okay.
This wasn't where Bar-Jonah wanted to be, obviously. Freedom aside, he had his eyes set on the Bridgewater State Hospital, a medium-security state facility housing the criminally insane and those whose sanity is being evaluated for the criminal justice system, a place that other prisoners talked very highly about as a far less restrictive environment. BJ had actually made a friend inside that transferred there, a guy named Wayne. In a letter to Bar-Jonah, he said, quote, "You should get your ass over here." Starting in early 1979, he, with the help of Tyra, his mother, started aggressively petitioning for his transfer, and after dozens of letters and calls, Bar-Jonah received a recommendation for evaluation. If he met the criteria of a, quote, sexually dangerous person, according to the state of Massachusetts, he would move in, and his life would get a whole lot more cush. On the day of his arrival, he was greeted by his best friend Wayne. The two shared a long embrace, and Wayne asked him what took so long. And I gotta wonder where the Arrested Development no touching stuff was.
No touching!
Just hugging Wayne like he's an old high school chum.
What was it? Was it Nance?
No, it wasn't Nance. Nance never went to jail, remember?
I know, I thought, you know, maybe there's just a part we hadn't heard about before.
Here's a quote from John E. Espy about the facility. BWSH, the Bridgewater State Hospital, was known in the pedophile community as graduate school. You could go in as a freshman child molester and come out with a doctorate in pedophilia. It was a place where snakes went to shed their skin.
Gross. Gross. Gross.
The Bridgewater State Hospital has been a stain on the Commonwealth for decades. The operating model was all wrong. It did a terrible job of dealing with and taking care of the people it was supposed to be serving. It put people who worked there as well as people who had been committed there in a terrible place, and a lot of really bad things happened. People died.
May 1979, Tyra wrote to the then director of forensic mental health for the state of Massachusetts, a guy named Dr. Nicholas Groth.
He sounds very bad.
She needed his help. Struggling to achieve permanent status at BWSH, she blamed one particular board member who happened to be black.
Oh boy, here we go.
So Groth said he'd look into the situation, and while waiting, a memo was issued at the end of May. It was from the Department of Corrections stating that Bar-Jonah would be considered for parole after serving a minimum 10-year sentence, October 1989 at the earliest.
Yeah, it didn't turn out that way.
Things change when you move from a prison to a hospital. July 30th, 1979, was a big day for BJ.
I don't like that either.
It was also a big day for Donna Summers, whose single Bad Girls had just hit number one on the Billboard Hot 100 chart, only to be passed by Chic's Good Times. All before the Knack would dominate September with their smash hit, My Sharona.
I won't sing it. I don't like that one very much.
Bar-Jonah wasn't charting.
My Sharona, Bar-Jonah.
However, a chart was being prepared. Two psychologists, both Roberts, Robert Moore and Levy, evaluated Bar-Jonah and both concluded that he was a predator, a sexually dangerous person, and would be allowed to stay at the Bridgewater State Hospital. However, here his sentence was a little bit different. No longer 18 to 25 years.
Oh, fuck.
Now, from one day to life.
Why? What was the justification for this?
Because now he's in a state hospital, even though it's still part of the Department of Corrections. It's no longer just like a prison. One day to life kind of means anything. But to the two Roberts, they were leaning towards the life part of that.
Okay.
Levy, in fact, was one of the reasons that Bar-Jonah remained locked up for as long as he was. He's a bit of a Dr. Loomis from the popular film franchise.
Oh, I know.
Halloween.
I know.
This more obese shape didn't get life. Nowhere near it. Unfortunately, in January of 1990, Bar-Jonah started itching for the outside and brought it up with his attorney. On both the 19th and 30th, he spoke with Dr. Lisa Brooks, a consulting forensic psychologist, to the court, sharing his plan with her. He wanted out. Bob, his brother, had relocated to Montana, and he was told he had a place to stay there. Bar-Jonah was looking forward to starting school to be a... What do you think, Kelly?
Nurse. Elementary school teacher.
A journalist.
Okay.
With his time in sight, he also invented a board game that he planned to publish. So get this, it's kind of like Ouija, but more hands-on.
Your movie. No,
that wasn't it, and it was that was a bad joke, and I'm so sorry.
Yeah, you should be sorry.
Reference to the small girl he strangled while playing Ouija last week. We didn't really bring up that there's a kind of a supernatural element that could have potentially explained what he was doing. We didn't bring that up at all. Like, the first time he attacked a girl was when he was playing Ouija, so maybe he unleashed the devil. I don't know.
Oh, he sounded fucked up long before that. Also, I don't want to give him a cop-out. Also,
I don't believe in that. So,
I mean, I probably do, but no.
He had also started a greeting card company. Apparently, he was quite the artist, and I'm going to make sure to include some sketches at some point in this report.
Ugh, gross.
Dr. Brooks wasn't buying it and wrote that he was still a sexually dangerous person who would, without question, reoffend. Another forensic psychologist named Leonard Bard, PhD, attempted to reevaluate Bar-Jonah on January 26th and February 2nd of 1990. Both times, he refused, saying that he didn't need it, but it was time for him to go. He had things to do. Bard did, however, do an in absentia evaluation. In absentia meaning without...
In absence.
Yep, without...
Literally.
Bar-Jonah present. There he was diagnosed with borderline personality disorder.
That's a fun one. That's one of my faves.
With psychopathic features. The doctor also noted Bar-Jonah's fantasies were highly bizarre in nature and included an interest in methods of torture, dissection, and the taste of human flesh.
Oh, no, he doesn't seem like he poses a risk.
Well, that's exactly what they're saying here, is that he needs to stay.
No, but the judge.
Well, no, it gets very complicated. His progress was minimal over the then 13 years of attempted treatment, and he was uncooperative in their attempts. Bar-Jonah, of course, disagreed and pointed out that he had written his victims apology letters.
It negates everything that was just said.
I don't have those letters, but after reading his shitty confession last week, I wish that I did, because...
It just shows how sociopathic he is, that he's that far out of touch, that he actually thinks that there is something he could legitimately complain about.
He felt that his apology should have been enough. That's what he thought. Not only tending to his needs from afar... Tyra, who was 61 when her son was incarcerated, made the 180-mile round-trip trek every week for 15 years. During their visits, he would demand more money, more goods, and more food, cookies in particular. With this escape route not working, the hunt for a God-fearing psychologist was on. a good Christian doctor or two who would better understand Bar-Jonah's special relationship, as well as God's ability to bring about real change.
I've always really disliked the phrase God-fearing.
Oh, yeah?
It seems to imply that your faith is based upon the degree to which you fear.
It's a fire brimstone kind of thing.
Yeah, it's definitely an old tea plan. I don't think that... Yeah, I don't like it.
Well, unlike the state-provided evaluations, this route was not going to be cheap. So, of course, Tyra, who had already been doing most of the groundwork anyway, with financial assistance of her older son, Bob, they found two Christian candidates in November of 1990, Richard Ober and Eric Schweitzer. The fee for their assessment, $5,000 each. During their analysis, Bar-Jonah went back to a familiar well, retelling his fabricated dark origin story of being assaulted by a group of older youths.
Okay, and you are 100% sure that that isn't true.
I mean, even his mother says that details weren't true. The injuries he would have sustained by being anally assaulted with a broomstick and sticks, having his friend lit on fire, would have ended with both of them in the hospital.
Okay, you would think, right?
You would think.
But also, like, what if he really was horribly beat to shit and his mother doesn't want to admit that she was such a bad mother that she didn't take him to the
they
hospital?
They had been to the hospital for other reasons.
Okay.
Multiple times.
All right.
And part of that story, the Eagle Scouts lie, saving his friend Kevin, the knife.
He's definitely a liar. There's no question about that. I'm just, you know, that's kind of a...
According to himself, the violent fantasies had left Bar-Jonah's brain. He had turned his back on his formerly homosexual urges, and in fact, following the formation of a pen pal relationship with an Arkansas woman outside, the two are now engaged. His fiancée would soon become his wife just as soon as he could get out. Ober called this a, quote, maturing of sexual attitudes. He also noted a traumatic incident that happened to Bar-Jonah while inside. And I'll say this right now, what I'm about to go into, plus the problems with the black board member, say a lot about Bar-Jonah and Tyra's apparently racist beliefs.
Oh boy.
October 2nd, 1989, Bar-Jonah claimed that during a strip search, a black prison guard attempted a rectal cavity search, and that when he resisted, the guard called 8, which is interesting because that's the same number of older kids that assaulted him in the other story, 8 other black guards to forcefully move him into a new cell. The same cell that earlier that day was used by the same guards to kill a man in. The mattress was actually still soaked in clotting blood.
Sweet.
Bar-Jonah said a, quote, big black buck forced him onto the mattress.
Buck?
Yeah. Where they all took turns raping him until he was bleeding from his rectum. Adding that one of them even filmed it with a VHS camera.
Huh.
They left him for dead, but after passing out, he found himself in the infirmary. Bar-Jonah claimed that he tried to take legal action, but the whole thing was elaborately covered up.
I mean, here's the thing. I do...
There's a problem with sexual abuse inside
right,
the prison.
Right. The odds that that actually happened are pretty slim.
And in that way, absolutely near impossible.
Okay.
In my opinion, like...
Okay.
It is tough.
What did this psychiatrist say?
Well, he noted that Bar-Jonah's response to the rape was, quote, adaptive. This incident demonstrates his ability to handle stress as a result of perceived sexual trauma and to control his impulses.
Okay.
So in conclusion, now $5,000 richer, Ober wrote, it is the opinion of this evaluator that Mr. Bar-Jonah is not at this time likely to victimize other due to his controlled desires.
Who will my what?
I think that's what $5,000 will get you. He didn't administer a single psychological test. However, Schweitzer did. A Rorschach test, you know, ink blot test, where the testes and interpretation of a blot on a paper is analyzed using psychological interpretations. The Minnesota Multifaceted Personality Inventory. Do you know this one?
Mm.
It's more of a standardized psychological test.
Can I give it to you?
I would love to take one. I actually pulled one up. You can do it for like $18 online. It evaluates and determines personality characteristics. I imagine it would be better if a professional administered the test.
I'm pretty professional.
He also did a THT or thematic apperception test where the patient is shown a series of picture cards. I don't know. I feel like I've seen this in a movie somewhere. It's less common than the Rorschach, A patient is shown a series of picture cards showing a variety of ambiguous characters that may include men, women, and or children, scenes and situations, and then they're asked to tell as dramatic a story as they can for each picture presented, including what led up to what they're seeing.
Okay.
It's kind of fun.
I feel like I'd be bad at that.
Maybe I saw this in like a UCB training class.
Oh, God. Oh, my God.
All these tests were used to determine personality traits and potential abnormal psychopathology in different ways. All tests that Bar-Jonah was familiar with. Very familiar. Schweitzer found no evidence of, quote, psychotic thinking style or sadistic or aggressive preoccupation with sexual ideation. In the opinion of these religious psychologists, the homosexual conversion, how well he handled his brutal rape in prison, having made a board game and testing it with other inmates, he was reformed, and without a doubt should be released without any qualifications or follow-up recommendations.
$5,000.
Yeah, I guess that's all it costs. Yeah.
Okay, is that person still alive?
I don't want to look into that right now.
I'm really hoping he's fucking dead.
Years later, just wishing death every episode.
Well, yeah, I mean,
that's the new drinking game.
Anybody who willingly participated in the freeing of this man
could have prevented a lot of damage and heartbreak. Years later, in the year 2000, a Cascade County attorney would say that their findings were inconsistent with reason and contradicted thousands of pages of information in his criminal file. On February 12, 1991, after making their case, Judge Steele ordered the immediate release of Bar-Jonah. But due to a whoopsie, and this is our fun moment of the episode, Kelly.
Oh, so this is it? Okay, I'm ready.
This. He was accidentally returned to his cell and forgotten about until almost July.
And what day was this?
This was February.
So the whole time he was just complaining and everybody's like, just shut the
fuck up. Supposed
to
be out of here.
Shut up. Everybody says that.
Yeah, I don't know how this happens or if it did happen, but in this case, I like it a lot and I'm going to
pretend.
Okay,
so who says this happened?
It was according to the source material. Quote,
really?
Forgotten about.
Wow.
June 28th, 1991, after 5,025 days inside, Nathaniel Bar-Jonah was now a free man, calling his now 75-year-old mom, Colette, of course, to pick him up. On the phone, he made sure Tyra brought a new, freshly starched pair of black pants and a white shirt. When she arrived, he was disappointed, complaining that what she had purchased was cheap. He changed in the bathroom, and they moved his possessions out to the car. Well, Tyra did most of the moving, because Bar-Jonah had apparently developed a bad back on the prison bunk beds.
Oh my god.
A guard assisted with the heavy boxes by grabbing a dolly after watching Tyra struggle, dropping several things, while Bar-Jonah sat in the front seat, shouting, "Hurry up, I haven't had dinner yet." Only home for a few days, Tyra started nagging Bar-Jonah with annoying ideas like, get a job. He told her that he'd been locked up for 15 years and was going to take it easy for a bit. Because, you know, Kelly, prison is hard.
So hard.
Lots of TV to watch, food to eat, and friends to catch up with. Not only did he ring up over $300 in collect call bills on a monthly basis while inside, he was now spending hours keeping up with his pen pals, which was over 300 very savory individuals, I'm guessing, including his Arkansas sweetie. This first bill that Tyra got was over $1,000.
Oh my God.
But soon that bill would be of less concern.
Oh my God.
August 9th, 1991 was a rainy day. You know, one of those late summer downpours. I always look forward to those. Those are really nice.
I do, especially when our entire state is on fire.
Yeah, it's very, Mrs. Surprise, which I'm thinking is an alias for this book. I don't know that for sure.
What a weird alias, though. Don't you typically go with, like, Jane Doe?
Could be her last name. Could truly be Miss Surprise. She was dropping off a package for her mother at the post office, leaving her then 7-year-old son, Michael, buckled up in the back seat. She was only going to be gone for a minute. Closing the door, running briskly into the building, she had no idea a monster was lumbering nearby and would spot her son through the fogged-up, rain-streaked glass of her car.
Wait. You told me that this episode was safe.
Bar-Jonah approached the car and opened the rear passenger side door. He stood still for a second, staring at the boy, before crawling inside. His long beard, greasy hair, and coonskin cap dripping on the seat.
This is not good.
He slammed his now 275-pound body, which is pretty lean for BJ standards, on top of the little boy. Michael tried to scream, but couldn't get anything out. He was being crushed and suffocated by the wet shirt of this stranger.
I don't get why. Like, why is this what he wants to do?
Suddenly, with almost superhuman strength, the encounter was interrupted by Miss Surprise, who had sprinted from the door of the post office. As she attacked Bar-Jonah, one punch landed hard on his face, causing his nose to bleed. "I just need to get out of the rain," he said, as he was pulled off of her son, freeing the boy up to take his first breath for a bit.
So hold on, she managed to pull him off?
Yeah.
Mama strength.
Mom strength. I mean, that's what happens when you see a lumbering monster attacking your son.
Yeah.
Bar-Jonah slipped and fell on the wet asphalt. Lifting her son from the seat, blood also came from his nose, and although still hard to breathe, he began to scream in horror of what happened so quickly. Michael's mother hadn't called the police, but a witness had, and they arrived quickly.
Okay.
But not quickly enough.
He was gone.
Just after Bar-Jonah had ran off.
Okay, so the 275-pound man running on foot evaded everyone?
Kelly, he was a track star.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
At the hospital, the mother and son struggled to give an accurate description of the attacker, mostly his wet shirt and that he smelled like a wet dog.
Excellent.
But what they gave was enough for an officer who thought it sounded a lot like Bar-Jonah 15 years prior. Mm. Discovering that he'd been released just 43 days earlier, a handful of officers were sent to Tyra's apartment around 3 p.m. where they found Bar-Jonah sitting in front of the TV eating mac and cheese. He argued that he had only hopped in the car because he was trying to get out of the rain, but Bar-Jonah had recently really gotten into walking, but not really for exercise. The officers didn't know that he had started trolling a nearby elementary school and loved to stand outside the playground at lunchtime. And this is kind of what he was doing on that day, too. He was out on one of his walks when he came across this boy in the car. Later at the police station, he came clean, writing a confession that he indeed intended to kill Michael. He was arraigned, released, and taken home by Tyra, where they had a big dinner because it was a big day. Bar-Jonah was upset because they weren't nice to him, and they told him that he was no longer welcome in the town of Oxford. After dinner, he looked up the address of the Surprises and called a cab. When Mrs. Surprise saw Bar-Jonah outside her home, in a panic, she turned off the lights, pretended that no one was home, and called the police. Bar-Jonah left before the police arrived.
Jesus. Oh, my God.
Ready for some criminal justice system blunders, Kelly.
We haven't gotten to those
Not
yet?
Not quite.
Really?
The case was referred immediately to probation by the police chief and district attorney with the idea that he would go directly back to jail. This is a clear breach of those rules.
Right, and also a clear indication that the pretense upon which he was released is fucking wrong.
More than likely to reoffend when you just straight up reoffend.
Right, yes.
But that didn't happen. When the case came before Judge Milton H. Raffleson in Dudley District Court, the 15 years that Bar-Jonah spent locked up wasn't brought up. Nor was his written confession or the late night visit to the Surprise house. The next day, Bar-Jonah was called to appear before another judge who wasn't informed of the prior appearance the day before. He found the evidence compelling and would charge Bar-Jonah with the assault and battery and entering a motor vehicle with the intent to commit a felony, that he would receive an indefinite sentence and return to Concord, not Bridgewater. But moments before the judge was going to hand down his decision, he was informed that a plea agreement had already been made.
What? Why?
It was because he had already seen a different judge the day before.
Okay, why did that judge offer him a plea deal?
I would imagine that the information wasn't brought forward or brought forward in a similar way.
Really?
That plea deal recommended 2 years of probation. And this judge, who was prepared to send him back and charge him with a felony, or attempt to commit a felony, plus the assault, he was forced to abandon his decision to return Bar-Jonah to prison. 2 years probation, but he did add something. He wanted a mental evaluation. Like the first judge, he wasn't told of Bar-Jonah's prior criminal background, and Bar-Jonah was presented to him as if he was a first-time offender.
See, I don't know, like, this whole idea of presented to him, isn't there any due diligence on his shoulders?
Seems very sloppy, right?
Like, was his clerk just really shitty? And if his clerk was that shitty, how did he not know he was that shitty or she?
The details of his cases keep slipping through the cracks because they're not properly documented or not properly displayed to the people who need to see him.
So gross.
And we're just getting started. It's now late 1991, and older brother Bob was now settled in the town of Great Falls, Montana. He had a good job teaching computer engineering at the Air Force base there, the Maelstrom base, the site of some very odd interactions between UFOs and nuclear weapons that we talked about early on in this podcast, and it's a topic that we're going to revisit.
Mm-hmm. It's also a lot less depressing.
It does seem that way, right? Mm-hmm. But back to Bob. He had made a place for himself in the Assembly of God community and had purchased several rental properties, including an apartment building that he said his mom and brother could move into. A change of scenery might do him some good. But moving out of state while on probation is no walk in the park, Inglot.
No. No.
It's a difficult process that has to go through something called the Interstate Compact Agreement. Most states straight up won't accept sexual or violent offenders, which makes total sense to me. Before a move is made, an agreement between states has to be locked in. At least you'd think so. Montana didn't know what was coming for him. Following sentencing, Bar-Jonah was told to report immediately, like right away, as soon as he left the courtroom, to probation.
Oh, he didn't, though?
Didn't do that. He also failed to schedule...
Hey, Bob! I'm coming, Bob! Well,
he said, hey, Tyra, pick me up outside. He failed to schedule a psychiatric evaluation, and the two drove home. Soon, she had rented a small trailer to pull behind her car. It was filled almost entirely with Bar-Jonah's possessions, including his shitty antique toys, which really we're going to get into probably next week. But over the weekend, I spoke with one of my friends from Great Falls, a guy I used to play shows with when I was touring around Montana. He actually used to see Bar-Jonah selling his stuff at the malls.
What?
He said that they were used McDonald's toys quality. So yeah, basically just trash. He told me lots of stuff that I'm hoping to bring into this.
He was, wow.
Well, they.
He knew who he was, though?
Uh-huh. One of his bandmates' mother was actually a jailer that guarded him. A small portion of the trailer space was given to Tyra for her clothes and a few keepsakes, but mostly it was Bar-Jonah's garbage. Mm-hmm. Only a week after sentencing and without contacting the probation office, the two were Montana bound, with a planned pit stop on the way or out of the way. August 29th, 1991, they started...
That's our anniversary!
Is it?
No, I mean the 29th, not 1991.
It started out like any good road trip. Right off the bat, Bar-Jonah had a headache and couldn't drive.
Oh my God.
Without any prior mention, he said that they were not going to be going directly to Montana, but they'd be heading south. Montana by way of Arkansas.
Okay, that is not Montana.
Change of plans, yeah. Mom.
We're going the opposite direction, essentially, Mom.
Yeah, to meet the woman he was planning on marrying, the woman of his dreams. And remember, this wasn't an easy thing for Tyra to be doing. She, at this point, was 75 years old and was forced to do 90% of the driving.
Yeah, here's the thing. I don't have the pity.
I kind of agree with you.
She, first of all, she brought him into this world. Second of all, she enabled every step along the way.
Seems like
helping him break his parole to go to another state and commit horrific crimes.
Well, we're not there yet. Since she was 75, she was only able to drive 5 hours a day before becoming completely exhausted, which is understandable, especially considering her co-pilot was constantly complaining about being hot and cramped, and that he wanted to stop at every fast food place that they passed.
Lord.
Even with a trailer full of toys, they stopped at every flea market along I-75, grabbing more toy cars and guns, jamming them in where they could. At rest areas, he would loiter, watching the kids play, sometimes giving them toys. One mother thanked him with a big hug, praising his generosity. He said it was just the Christian thing to do.
Yeah. That's great.
This detour took an entire week, but eventually they arrived, parking in front of an old cream-colored mobile home just outside Little Rock, Arkansas, the home of Bar-Jonah's fiancée, Sandy, and her two boys, aged 8 and 10. He'd started writing Sandy when connected by a cellmate. She was looking for a good man to help her raise her boys. Great place to look. They hit it off quickly and exchanged. I don't want to say everyone incarcerated is a bad person. But
no, because there is a lot of, as this story shows, I mean, justice is misserved on both ends of the, you know, of the spectrum.
But
there are people who are in there who shouldn't be, and there are obviously people out who should be in. So the whole system's fucked.
They hit it off quickly and exchanged weekly letters for 2 years. Although Sandy was almost 10 years his senior, Bar-Jonah was excited, especially to meet her kids. He shared with her that they were his favorite age, such impressionable minds and imaginations. She had lived a hard life. A handful of husbands came and left, difficult, abusive men. When Bar-Jonah arrived, he wasn't exactly what she had expected. He had sent her old, worn pictures from prison, and they hadn't fully captured his essence.
Literally?
Yeah. His again ballooning weight, the jowls, and the smell.
The smell.
How do you kick off the first conversation with your prison fiancé?
Hey.
Right. Well, in this case, by immediately talking about marriage. All at once, Bar-Jonah had decided to call off the rest of the trip. He'd be moving in with Sandy, staying in Arkansas. They could move in right away. But they couldn't share a bedroom until they were wed. There was to be no sex before marriage. It went against his religion.
No, it didn't.
There were no spare bedrooms in her small trailer. So I guess Bar-Jonah would have to move into the boys' room. He walked in and declared the bottom bunk his. Sandy was in shock and was told to change the sheets. He was exhausted from all the co-piloting that he'd been doing and needed a nap. She changed the sheets and left him momentarily to get comfortable. When she smelt cigarette smoke and entered her children's room, found him sitting in his underwear smoking. Asked to stop, told that this was a non-smoking house, he took one more puff and put it out on the bedpost. Sandy's boys weren't exactly jumping for joy at the arrival of Mom's new boyfriend. They already wanted their room back. It wasn't fair that this gross stranger was sleeping on their bed. And he smelled like shit.
Yeah.
What are you doing over there?
The image and scent that you're forcing us to contemplate combined with all of the horrible things he's done.
I'm not done.
And all the horrible things we know he's going to do.
Not even close.
I know that the smell is petty compared to the rest of it, but I think it might be the camel that's breaking the straw's back. I think it's pushing me over the edge. Like, I'm actually, I can
feel it?
Acid.
Right here in the middle of the chest? An exhausted Tyra helped to make dinner, but Sandy insisted that she rest. She was visibly exhausted. Having not had a home-cooked meal in weeks, he used it as an excuse to pile his plate like Joey Chestnut at a Golden Corral. During dinner, the light above the table gave Sandy a good look at Bar-Jonah's teeth.
Oh, God.
Or lack of. Yep. Again, what was left was rotting out. This time, he didn't have the prenatal medication excuse. They were just fucked up. Bad teeth. And there always seemed to be a crusty buildup in the corner of his mouth.
Oh, my God.
She thought, how would I ever kiss this man, let alone sleep with him? And this was something that the two discussed later that night. She expressed that it had been a long time since she had gotten any, and that she had needs.
Hold on. So she went from, like, being disgusted with the idea of touching him to actually wanting...
She didn't want to kiss him. She just wanted...
God. Oh, Jesus. I'm...
Yeah, Bar-Jonah refused. He had saved himself all these years and wasn't going to do it now, not until they were married. He reminded
her. Hold on, how old is he at this point again?
Were you going to shame him for saving
himself? No, I'm just thinking that he hasn't because...
He's nowhere near Carell's 40-year-old virgin.
Well, no, because he's like lovable and harmless.
Oh,
and...
That's true. He reminded her that he wasn't even going to share a bed with her due to temptation. But he did like that bottom bunk. It was even big enough that the littlest one could sleep with him. He thought it would be a good way for them to bond. This was one of the first times that Tyra had gotten to see just how grossly her son interacted with others. I still think she tried to push it back. She couldn't help but see how he was talking about the boys.
The mother, mm-hmm. like the boy's mother, doesn't have a strong reaction
to
that. No, she
does. And we'll get to that. Okay. But Tyra, she thought that if she could just get him married, get him to Montana, get him a job, things would be fine.
Totally, totally. Yeah, good call. She good thought thinking.
That Montana was in the middle of nowhere, and it's a place where he certainly couldn't get into trouble, and where her and Bob could keep an eye on him, that he had truly found God. Those were the things that she was hoping for.
Yeah, fuck you, lady.
After dinner, Sandy decided to call it a night early. Tyra was going to sleep on the couch. Bar-Jonah, he was on the bottom bunk, relaxing after dinner, smoking again, even though they'd already been over that. And Sandy was lying in her bed, unable to sleep. She spent the night rereading the letters the two had exchanged over 2 years, professions of love and desire, and how excited he was to help raise her kids. Of course, Sandy had known that he was a criminal, but there was a story that he shared with her at dinner that wasn't exactly the most accurate. He said that as a young man, Bar-Jonah attempted to choke a couple teenagers who had jumped him one night in a parking lot.
Well, that's a fun twist.
That he was falsely convicted because the boys had lied. During his time inside, he had come to forgive the boys with a little help from God. She could see in Tyra's eyes that he was actively lying about this.
And?
Oh, he then shared with her the traumatic stories of being assaulted in the woods as a boy and by the guards inside. Sandy, at this point, became frightened of Bar-Jonah. She didn't want him sleeping with her boys. Initially, she thought that maybe he had just gotten used to the bunk beds in prison, but yeah, the suggestion that her youngest sleep next to him was too much for her. But not enough that she changed anything until the next morning, where she got up early, she made biscuits and gravy with a side of grits and get the fuck out of here's. She asked him to leave. He finished eating without saying anything, told Tyra that it was time to leave. Tyra thanked Sandy, and they were off.
Okay, that just seems like the most unexpected reaction ever.
Right? Because traditionally, he didn't take to rejection, let alone criticism.
Right, like he was used to getting exactly what he wanted, Augustus Gloom style.
Maybe he found out that that wasn't what he wanted. I don't know. Maybe she was a bad cook.
That would be, wow, okay.
Although I'm sure Tyra was happy to be headed to Montana towards her son's seemingly second chance, it was also back to the exhausting road with her inconsiderate co-pilot. Again, she drove 90% of the time. He really enjoyed South Dakota because it was flat, straight, and had a little traffic. To avoid the possibility of driving through a snowstorm late at night, Tyra stopped in Gillette, Wyoming. After dinner, her son decided to go on one of those walks. He was gone for several hours, arriving home at 2 a.m. We don't really know what he did during that window, but the next morning, he slept an hour past checkout, and on their way out of town, he took down a Paul Bunyan breakfast. 3 eye-up eggs, which I believe is sunny-side-up. I like eye-up, though. No, eye-up? I saw that, and I was like, hell yeah.
Okay, this author is gross. A serial killer himself.
He's doing some weird stuff, but I love that detail. 3 pieces of sausage, 3 pieces of bacon, hash browns with a side of gravy, 4 pieces of toast, orange juice, and 4 cups of coffee. Continuing west on I-90, they quickly approached the Treasure State, the last best place, Big Sky Country, Montana. And for folks who don't know, it's a big state. It's the 4th biggest next to California, Texas, and Alaska, but it's like unique in its largeness. There's truly nothing like it. Are just over 1 million residents are spread out over 147,000 square miles. We got deer, bighorn sheep, bears. Kelly, what do you love most about Montana?
That Nathan Bar-Jonah is not living here anymore?
So major cities, I guess quote-unquote major cities, are spread out with hours between them. Yeah, the vastness is just, it can't be understated. They passed Billings, which is one of my least favorite places to be in the state.
It's awful.
Terrible,
flat, hot, awful place.
It's a bad place. Tyra decided not to chance it, and they spent the night in Bozeman. The next morning, they left, driving through Butte, home of Evel Knievel, and the largest Superfund site, the Berkeley Pit, eventually pulling into Great Falls.
The only place that can compete with Billings for shittiness in the state of Montana.
I have friends who are from there who are listening to this story.
It's a really shitty, horrible place. I know good people from there. It is a shitty, horrible, ugly place.
I've never had too much fun in Great Falls, I'll tell you that. I am going to visit there before the end of this report. When all was said, driven, and done, the trip had taken more than 3 weeks. They pulled up to Bob's white duplex on First Avenue. Tyra felt like she was going to collapse. Bar-Jonah said he needed the car. He had some things to do. And that's where we'll pick up next week.
Oh, thank God.
As Bar-Jonah starts a small business selling bullshit used toys, the Montana Department of Corrections are blindsided with an unauthorized transfer, and old habits die hard. Or never died at all.
Oh, my God.
Actually, it's not next week. Because, Kelly, we're taking a little break with something from you. Is that what it's looking like?
We're cryptiding.
Is that what we're doing?
We are.
Well, that'll be fun.
I might survive.
How are you feeling?
Awful.
Not great?
Terrible. No good.
Hope you're doing great at home. If you like our show and want to help us make it even better, grab something spooky at shop.frightday.com. Great stuff in the Byron Cereal Corner store. If you like this, we got plenty more for society members when you join at patreon.com/Frightday or cult.frightday.com. That's where Kelly will be recovering from this episode. We're starting that series, the Kelly's Recovery Sessions. The first one, we talked a little bit about film soundtracks, the lost art of putting...
Did you put my playlist
Damn,
up?
Damn, I didn't. I'll throw that up.
I worked very hard
I
on
know,
that.
I know. I worked very hard. All the time.
I know.
There's over 50 other episodes of Behind the Screams, which of course is the show behind the show, along with bonus episodes of Captain Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, Byron's Serial Corner, The Writer's Room, Toast to Toast PM with Wine Kelly, Cinema Autopsy, and more. You get exclusive merch discounts, the first 10 episodes, and the feeling of helping us the heck out. And if you like this series in particular, tell a true crime friend. And if you haven't rated or reviewed our show, pick up your phone and give us some stars and type out some nice words, please and thank you. That would be really great.
It would be great.
Anything else, Kelly?
If you could specify to Byron that for his next Serial Corner installment, he needs to either pick a serial killer that never harmed a child in any way or find a stand-in for his captain.
Well, we're a ways away from that. We still got more Bar-Jonah to talk about. But until next time, Kelly, where are you going to be?
You can find me on Twitter at Kelly Frightday. You can email me, kelly@frightday.com. I'm trying to poke around on Discord, and I pop in and say some things on Facebook sometimes, but my, it's still difficult. But really, just say hi anywhere. You guys are great. Try and fill my brain with happy things if you can.
And those places are facebook.com/group/frightday and discord.frightday.com. I forgot to say that.
Those places, yeah.
And I'm at Byron McKoy on Twitter and Instagram. Byron@frightday.com is my email address. I've been not hanging out in Byron's brain on Discord as much. I cannot handle more of...
Of this? Welcome to my world.
Well, until next Frightday, I'm Byron.
I'm Kelly, or a shell. Love Kelly.
Shelley.
Yeah. Oh. Although she's the only person that's made a good decision
so far,
thus far in this
right?
whole story.
Pretty good. Well,
you've been listening to an Audio Wall original. Produced by Byron McKoy. Theme music provided by Cemeteries. For more programs like this, visit audiowool.co.